You are indeed watching Breakthrough News, and this is the Freedom Side Live. I am one of your hosts, Eugene Perrier, here, as always, alongside my intrepid co-host, Rania Kalik. Rania, great to be back with you.
Eugene, it's so good to be back with you. It's been a while.
It has been a while. We were actually, I think, in person the last time we were here.
That's true. And we hopefully will be in person again soon, but for now, we'll have to do it this way.
Indeed.
But yeah, lots coming up. Lots has happened in our absence.
The queen has died.
So much has happened.
That's maybe the big news.
Moment of silence.
Yes. And I did see someone actually put out like a workout routine to honor the queen. And like in the, you know, obviously in a workout routine, you put in a little rest period. Instead of saying like rest for 1 minute, it says 1 minute of silence in honor of the queen. So people really
I did not do that workout. I don't know about you, but I did not do that workout.
Thankfully. but as you can imagine, in honor of the queen's death, we're going to be talking quite a bit about the crimes of the British Empire, which are legion. In fact, we could probably have an 8-hour show and still not cover them all. But from India to Ireland to Kenya, we're going to be touching very heavily on the reality of what the British Empire really meant and continues to mean in some parts of the world. We're going to talk about the ongoing conflict in Ethiopia. We're going to be talking about the maybe it's not unbelievable, but at least the terrible situation in Jackson, Mississippi with the water crisis that's happening there. And also Chile and the situation that happened there with the referendum on the new constitution, which did not succeed. So as you can see, we've got quite a bit lined up here for the show. So this would be a great time for you to let whoever, however, know that you are watching this show so that whoever's following you can be following us. And of course, everyone who is watching on YouTube, which is more or less how you must be watching, you make sure you hit that subscription button and the bell so you can get the alerts so that all of the fantastic content, including Dispatches with Rania Kalik, will come to you directly. You won't even have to go searching for it. Just Breakthrough News injected into your veins. You won't regret it.
That should be our tagline.
Yeah.
Breakthrough News injected into your veins or something. I know it sounded cooler the way you said it, but I think we should go with it.
I think it'll be good. I think hopefully that'll become at least a meme in our chat that people will start saying stuff like that.
but also, Eugene, also we should mention that you can donate directly now on YouTube, depending on which country you're in most countries, I think. Yeah, you can donate directly. You'll see the donate button right underneath, which helps support the Freedom Side and all our other awesome shows. And then, of course, you can also become a regular contributor by becoming a patron at patreon.com/breakthroughnews.
Perfect. thank you. I don't know why I didn't think you were going to say the whole thing. I just got excited, I guess, because
I weirdly paused. I was like,
pause for effect.
Wait for it.
Pause
for
effect.
Exactly.
patreon.com/breakthroughnews. Go there. Subscribe. Hit the bell for the alerts and tell everyone you know that the Freedom Side is live right now and they should watch. Well, Rania, before we get into some of the other pieces we want to touch tonight, an issue that you've actually touched a couple times on Dispatches quite well, and we've talked about here in the show, this issue of Taiwan and how the U.S. is turning Taiwan into this, you know, political football to push this new Cold War with China and how dangerous that is. And now we're in even sort of deeper morass here. The Senate has taken the first step. Well, a committee in the Senate has taken the first step, the Foreign Relations Committee, to passing a new bill, the Taiwan Policy Act of 2022, which would basically, you know, revise the Taiwan Relations Act, but it would give Taiwan like $4.5 billion. It would normalize some of the more the military shipments. It would lay out what the sanctions would be on China if they do something the U.S. thinks they shouldn't be doing on Taiwan, which is, of course, their own territory. And then it also supports Taiwan's participation in international organizations. And that is a huge issue because it's really at least comes up to the line, if not steps over, breaching the issue of the One China policy. So this is obviously, if it was able to pass, and of course it has to go, it's now cleared the committee, so it's got to go in many different places in the Senate and then also up to the president's desk. But if it was to pass, I mean, this would be a major escalation on the issue of Taiwan. And it all kind of started with this Nancy Pelosi trip. And it just seems week after week after week, it's being pushed harder and harder as a way I don't really know exactly what they're trying to do, but the saber rattling is troubling.
No, it's, I mean, it's so reckless. We're already in this proxy war with Russia and Ukraine. You want to do another one with another nuclear armed power over Taiwan. I mean, that's what the US is doing right now. It's trying to take on Russia and China at the same time. It's trying to, it's even said, we've heard officials, they want to use the Ukraine playbook in Taiwan, which they would absolutely lose at. But I mean, it just speaks to the fact that, you know, another story that we're going to be talking about at some point during the show today is the situation with the water in Jackson, Mississippi, and how they don't have clean water and the government isn't investing in giving them clean water by replacing their pipe system, which would cost, I think, about $1 billion. And you just mentioned $4 billion for Taiwan for this Cold War that nobody wants except for US elites. I mean, it's just insane and shows you the priorities in this country.
Yeah, it really does. I mean, it, obviously, we can talk about the I can't even count how much money has been given to Ukraine at this point. I lose track because every time I turn around, it's billions of dollars. And the other thing about it, to speak to the point you're making, Rania, about priorities, is just how uncontroversial these things are considered. Like, the issue of the government providing water to Jackson, Mississippi is this huge controversial issue in Mississippi, and the state is trying to stop it. And even some Democrats in Congress saying, we got to take the power away from the city and do all these different things, as rather than just fix the problem, which everyone knows what to do and how to do it. But when it's like Ukraine, Taiwan, it's like, oh, what do we need? $54 billion, $100 billion. They need missile systems. They need this, they need that. Sign it over and send it over there. I mean, it reminds me of Hurricane Katrina when it came out not that long afterwards that some of the money from the Army Corps of Engineers that was being used in Iraq was actually money that had originally been earmarked to help shore up the levees in New Orleans. So there was like this direct connection between the defunding of communities at home and funding of these wars and this military machine abroad. And here it is yet again right in front of our face. And like you said, you know, these are nuclear powers. This is a deeply felt issue, you know, for people in China. And it really is just, in some ways, amazing. And when you look at also the depth of it, like, I don't know if you fully followed it, but like the governor of Indiana went to Taiwan. I mean, all these just completely random people are like going to show how tough they are against China. I mean, it's absurd.
Yeah, because they're auditioning for their actual constituents, which aren't the people who vote for them or the people they supposedly represent. They are weapons companies and the national security state and the Pentagon. I mean, that's just wild. The governor of Indiana going to Taiwan. Like, I know there's not some Taiwanese constituency in Indiana that he's like doing that on behalf of. That is purely for like campaign donations.
Yeah, you know, he also went to Israel last year after the Gaza war. I believe he was there with Ted Cruz, and they went to like the one house that had been, you know, messed up and from a rocket.
Like the backyard had like a little like a dent in the ground from like a homemade rocket that fell like 100 meters away from it, kind of situation.
Exactly. Yeah. And they were doing this, they were like pointing, like, look at the damage. Look at what these terrorists have done. And it's just, I mean, obviously the governor of Indiana, you know, is an important Republican official. But I mean, it just shows how absurd the whole kabuki theater is, as you point out, that obviously no, you know, the farmers of southern Indiana are not asking for this. The people working in the auto plants, you know, are not asking for this. It's just like, what on earth is going on where this is considered normal behavior? It's just the imperial conceit. It's almost like an illness that these things are considered normal as opposed to completely and totally ridiculous and absolutely performative, quite frankly.
Oh my gosh. It's really stunning too, because if you actually poll Americans, like about what issues they care about, like one thing that never registers is Taiwan. I mean, you might be able to poll Americans and say like, would you support like the US intervening if Taiwan was attacked, which is very specific wording meant to get the answer of yes, we do. And sometimes it's a little over 50%. A lot of times it's not, but if you let a poll after poll, nowhere do you see China or Russia at the top unless it's specifically asked about. What people care about is actually like the economy, their ability to provide for their families, to put food on the table, being able to keep up with inflation, interest rate, things that actually affect their daily lives, not Taiwan. Like,
I know. Well, here we are. Anyway, though, definitely if you're more interested in this issue, you know, go to YouTube. You're on YouTube. Check the archives there of our videos. We've done a lot of really interesting things, especially a couple with Dr.
And more
Kim
to come, by
Hammond.
The way. More to come on Taiwan, too. Boom. I was going to say more to come on Taiwan as well. But yeah, we've the socialist program, dispatches, the freedom side. We've all delved into Taiwan, and we have an upcoming episode of our new show, Overlap.
Yes.
Will be an episode on Taiwan coming up soon, so keep your eye out for it. And hit the bell so you get a notification.
There it is. Well, now we want to turn to our first story of the show regarding the crimes of kings and queens in the Isle of Great Britain. And we are turning first to India, and we are very happy to be joined as we continue the conversation by Prasanth R., who's a journalist with NewsClick and People's Dispatch. Prasanth, as always, thanks so much for being back with us.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a very, very interesting topic.
Indeed. Well, before we jump into it, I want to play a clip from Tucker Carlson, the most popular talk show host in the United States, where he had a message for the people of India about how they should be reacting to their own history.
In the real world, the one that we live in, strong countries dominate weak countries, and that trend shows no sign of changing. The very least you can say about the English is that they took their colonial responsibilities seriously. They didn't just take things, they added. When the US government withdrew from Afghanistan after 20 years, we left behind airstrips, shipping containers, and guns. When the British pulled out of India, they left behind an entire civilization, a language, a legal system, schools, churches, and public buildings, all of which are still in use today. Here's the train station the English built in Bombay, for example. There's nothing like that in Washington, D.C. right now, much less in Kabul or Baghdad. Today, India is far more powerful than the U.K., the nation that once ruled it. And yet, after 75 years of independence, has that country produced a single building as beautiful as the Bombay train station that the British colonialists built? No, sadly, it has not. Not one. So despite what they may be claiming on Twitter tonight, the British Empire was more than just genocide. In fact, the British did not commit genocide, except arguably against the Dutch during the Boer War. The British did give the world the Magna Carta and habeas corpus and free speech. They helped end the transatlantic slave trade, as well as the ritual murder of widows in India. The British Empire spread Protestant Christianity to the entire world. It published some of the greatest literature ever written and produced the finest manufactured goods ever made anywhere at any time, including now. It was an impressive place run by impressive people. We will see many empires going forward, but we will never see one so benign.
There's a lot there, so maybe I'll just ask you, Prasanth, what your reaction is to this clip from America's most popular TV host.
I mean, the short answer is basically I don't need to answer at all. You just need to sort of invert everything he said, and that's a 20-minute segment for you, because you know, every line just at the, you know, make it the exact opposite that that's a true story. But, you know, I mean, I think I watched this clip yesterday, if I'm not mistaken. And, you know, at one level, as someone who read basic history textbooks, there was a sense of incredulity and shock. It's a bit amusing now because it's like sixth time watching it, maybe. But, you know, then as a journalist, I was like just sort of at some level astounded because of, you know, how someone comments on, it's like, say, me talking about the physics and biology of marathon running or something like that, because it's so absurd. But yeah, I mean, but keeping that aside, I think what Tucker Carlson is saying here is the extreme version. It's very proper, probably politically incorrect to say that in many places, because people recognize it as racist and all that. And so people don't say it in that way so much anymore. But there's been a very long history of revisionist, you know, history making and myth making about the impact of the British Empire, and it's very much widely prevalent even now. There's, especially in the UK, I believe there's a fair amount of nostalgia for colonial times. There's this entire school of historians who goes about many of these things. You know, oh, the British bought trains. For some reason, everyone loves trains and trains running on time. It's a strange fascination. I never get that. It's like, it's interesting because, you know, when you talk about trains, and I think in the early 1920s there was a rebellion in the state I come from, in Kerala, and one of the punishments that the British meted out was they basically threw a huge number of people into a very narrow railway, a railway car, so to speak. And by the time the train had completed its journey, 64 people had died out of suffocation. So, you know, that's also the history of trains when we talk about India. But I think it's very important to sort of note that the school of thought does prevail. But it's very essential to counter it, because it's a bit like saying that, you know, if I stick a knife to your throat and you fight back, then I go back home and pat myself on the back for, you know, teaching you how to fight or something like that. But I think some numbers are really important in this context. You know, for instance, the fact that the claim he makes the British never committed genocide. I mean, the most obvious answer to it is the Bengal famine of the 1940s, where, you know, explicitly because of government policies and modern academic studies have proven it, that this was a famine which was caused by British imperial policies as opposed to weather conditions, which is how often a lot of famines take place. And this was because the needs of the population were not taken into account. The Indian people were not taken into account. Food was diverted to war needs. Winston Churchill, who celebrated as a hero, movies are made about him. Specifically, he is believed to have written that at this point, the needs of the Indians are less important. Even put a note saying, why hasn't Gandhi died, when his aides were saying that people died? And this is one end of the colonial spectrum. On the other end, you have the decades immediately after, in the 1750s and stuff, where another famine takes place, about 10 million people killed right after the British take over the rule of the region of Bengal. And all this money was basically just completely siphoned off into the United Kingdom. And I think this is something a lot of modern scholars are pointing out, that it's not that the whole wealth of the West, as we see today, not only of the United Kingdom, it's important to note, because the United Kingdom also served as a source of a lot of capital for the United States, for other countries in Europe. All this money did come from India and other colonies. And India is an important source. I'm going on a rant.
No. This is crucial.
The economist Uttam Patnaik has pointed out that I think the numbers are around $45 trillion. That was the amount of money that went from India to the United Kingdom over the course of its colonial history. So whether you look at, the loot and the drain of wealth, whether you look at the kind of atrocities that were committed, whether you look at, at so many levels, colonization's impact continues to this day. And, no one has got to, forget reparations or anything of that sort. No one has even got an apology for some of these atrocities.
Yeah, no, that's so, so important to point out. That $45 trillion number is just like, you can't even really imagine what that amount of wealth looks like. But people like Tucker Carlson, I mean, he's really saying what a lot of people think but don't say out loud, also in the West, which is the entire West is so wealthy, the developing world is so impoverished. Obviously, it must be because the West did something right. And it's like, no, the West just stole, literally looted the most resource-rich areas of the world. And, they had to steal it because they had nothing to trade, because they don't have anything in the global North, which is, of course, you pointed out the Patnaiks. I mean, they make that argument quite well in their book about imperialism. And, just to add about the trains, I mean, one thing that's so fascinating to talk about the trains is those trains were built to extract wealth. They weren't built so Indians could travel around India. They were built so that the British could take wealth from the inside of the country to ports, so they could literally steal. And the same could be said for, colonies all across Africa as well, in the way that Europe, de-developed Africa. But now I'm ranting. I mean, it's just so, it's outrageous to hear that mentality. But, I'm curious, what has the conversation been like in India? Because I imagine, the West has a very good global propaganda apparatus, particularly through Hollywood film, right? That's able to project this idea of the West as being this kind of like paradise sort of place that's better than the global South. And, as somebody who lives in the Middle East, that resonates with people sometimes. And so you do see, unfortunately, in some places, a certain segment of the population does revere the British Empire a little bit because, have historical amnesia and that sort of propaganda. So I'm curious if there's like a debate inside India, or is it kind of like across the board, people understand the British Empire was bad?
So, I mean, I think at one level, there is, of course, the impact of the freedom struggle still continues to this day to a large extent. And we have to be very clear about it, because all of us grew up reading these, stories in our history textbooks. They were the kind of dramas and plays we did at school, all that kind of stuff. So there's a long history, and the national freedom struggle was very much embedded in, I think, all of our minds from a very young age as well. So on the one hand, that is very strongly there. So like I said, it's even your basic history textbooks in India always make that aspect very clear. There's barely any, in how people study history, there's at least at a school level, at a college level, there's not really too much of nostalgia, so to speak. It's very clearly identified what the British exactly did to India. A very important thing I must also mention is that, you know, today we talk a lot about two aspects. One is a rivalry in South Asia, the constant tensions that are there, India, Pakistan, for instance, and or for that matter. So in all of these rivalries very strongly were influenced by what the British did. I mean, there's a story that the person who was finally responsible for drawing the line between India and Pakistan did so in about 5 weeks or so, and he had never traveled east of France before he actually went and drew that line. And, you know, I think 13 million people were impacted in 1947 because of those lines, which just destroyed, you know, an entire generation's lives and traumatized them in so many ways, in addition to deaths. But for that matter, even the what in South Asia we call communalism, which is a very uniquely South Asian word in some senses, the kind of religious polarization-based politics, a lot of this is completely comes from the British times, because the British very early on decided that their best way to stay in control in India was to try to pit the Hindus and the Muslims against each other, especially the elite sections. So for the longest time, that has been their policy. This was their stated policy, by the way. It's important to note that the fact that British officials long ago said that just as the Romans had the policy of divide and rule, this is our policy in India as well. And that continues to have an impact today, because the kind of religious violence, the kind of religious tensions that we see today, the kind of majoritarian politics that we see today, all of it stems from that British time period. So in answer to your question, while at one level, I think, of course, a lot of people do watch The Crown. There's a lot of, tabloid gossip, which is happily consumed by all of us. But that's one aspect of it. But I think at a deeper level, maybe one issue that we are dealing with in some ways to connect it to domestic aspect is the fact that today we are also ruled by the people of those political ideology who actually did compromise with the British. So, you know, there's a very interesting current connect as well, which we're not, I think, still entirely dealt with. That conversation is still kind of going on. But as far as nostalgia goes, it's, I think, way, way less prevalent than in many other parts of the world, because especially immediately after independence, this notion of us having to struggle, Indians having to struggle to throw out the British, of having defeated the mightiest empire in the world through a mass movement, because this was not a compromise. Of course, the elites were involved, but this was not a power handling deal between the British and certain elites. This was really a mass movement. And very important to note, a mass movement with workers, the farmers, the struggling masses of India's people were very actively involved. It was the kind of utter despair they faced that brought them continuously to the streets, that made them sacrifice their lives, that made them spend long years in very hideous jails and all kinds of condition. Men, women, children, across castes, across religions. It was a powerful, inspiring movement in many senses. And it is equally true of many countries across the world as well. The way they overthrew their colonizers, it was not a, like I said, it was not a dinner party. It was, freedom was snatched, struggling from the British, and which is why, again, ending with Tucker Carlson's notion that, they gave us a civilization, which I think is one of the most offensive things he says. But also the fact that whether it be free press, whether it be habeas corpus, whether it be democracy, all these were not given by the British. They were snatched. They were pulled after decades of struggle from them. The British were unwilling to give us any of these. Generations of Indians, generations of people across the world, generations of people struggled to actually get this through militant means, through armed struggles, through peaceful struggles, through a number of ways. And all of this formed the tapestry, the base of which countries like India and so many other countries which fought off colonialism are formed today.
No, I think that's such an important point. And it's like the one thing that Tucker Carlson, sort of his historical timeline, he says, well, of course, now India is more powerful than the UK. And it's like, yes, it's after British colonialism left, India built itself into one of the major global powers. But obviously one of the oldest civilizations, you know, in the history of the world. I mean, there's so many different levels to it. But, you know, really quickly, I did want to touch on this issue. And I'm glad you mentioned the issue of sort of the freedom struggle and historical memory, because it's been interesting this week for me in watching the Indian media to see how aggressively effectively, many of the forces, you know, more to the right, more affiliated with the ruling party, have been trying to say, oh, it wasn't just everybody else. You know, we were also in there. We were also involved. So, I mean, talk about that a little bit more if you could, because I think it's an important thing, because it seems now, you know, I know the flag changing for the Navy, that, you know, the Prime Minister and others are really trying to use this anti-colonial agenda to sort of speak to the rest of the world and define themselves as something that certainly perhaps the history doesn't bear out.
Right. So the Indian right wing, like I said, it has a long tradition of it is in relationship with the British, with colonialism itself, which is very ambivalent in some senses. And if you take some of the examples, go into outright collaboration as well, because for many of these sections in the Hindu right wing, especially, they saw the Muslims or the years of Muslim rule before as a bigger threat. And, you know, they were really concerned about the idea that what we needed was to establish a Hindu nation, as opposed to the idea of a secular country or of a country of all communities that the mainstream national movement did propose. So there was this constant sense of tension that has always existed between these two strands. And this has always been a problem for the right wing in India, because having no real record to speak of during the freedom struggle, they've really sort of, you know, always struggled to sort of say, lay a claim on, say, the history of India, so to speak, the history of modern India, so to speak. So one way for them has to sort of been to, say, claim this history, or, you know, this history of monarchs, of kings of the 17th and 18th centuries, and draw that kind of tradition, and then bring it under the umbrella of a Hindu, say, rebellion, so to speak. So, for instance, you have one of the most famous revolutionary heroes of India, Bhagat Singh, who was a communist, who was hanged by the British at a very young age, who just before he was being hanged was reading a book by Lenin, and, you know, his writings extremely inspirational. His most famous work, of course, which is most well known, is, you know, Why I'm an Atheist. So that really pretty much explains his point of view. But also, he did mass movement work against religious polarization. But if you look at the right wing, for instance, there's been this huge attempt to sort of, say, convert him into some kind of a icon of a kind of right wing nationalism, which removes all of these elements as well. And there are a lot of other people, for instance, who worked in the, you know, who were active parts of the national movement. There have been various attempts to include them, to sort of bring them under the Hindu umbrella and portray that as the civilizational tendency which sort of fought off the Muslims, he fought off the British, etc., etc. So this is actually a very devious sort of political agenda that has been going on. There's been a lot of conflict over history in recent times in India, especially since 2014, when the Narendra Modi government came to power. A lot of rewriting of the textbooks that has been taking place. You know, if you look at some of the, the kind of artwork, the kind of culture, the kind of television that comes out of it, a lot of it focuses on this notion of, a kind of a very different narrative from really what actually happened. So there's this kind of revisionism which takes place as well. And which is why I said, I think it goes in parallel, the kind of nostalgia for the British colonialism on the one hand. And on the other hand, you have this kind of nostalgia for a pure Hindu India, neither of which really existed. And the two kind of actually very well go hand in hand.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, amazing history, super interesting history, and really crucial for, I think, people to understand in this context with all of the pageantry that's all over the TV here in the United States. But Prasanth, as always, we really appreciate you being willing to join. I couldn't more highly recommend the work that you all do at NewsClick and Peoples Dispatch. Fantastic on covering all of these issues in the subcontinent and around the world. And we just really appreciate you giving us some of your time here on the Freedom Side.
Thank you so much, Eugene and Rania. Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm reminded, Eugene, of just a heads up, a little bit of a teaser. I'm going to be doing an episode of Dispatches soon about Saudi Arabia. Mm. And Saudi Arabia literally would not exist without the British Empire. Neither, I mean, they financed the Saudi royal family.
Oh,
they
we saw Lawrence of Arabia. Wahhabism. Peter O'Toole.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, they financed conservative, like all the Islamic extremism that like everybody freaked out about for the last 20 years, 30, whatever, 25 years, the war on terror. I mean, you can literally draw a line. It's not even an indirect one to the British.
You know, another one is Oman, is one that people don't know about. Like, literally, I mean, Oman even maybe even more, actually, in terms of how it was created and sort of much later in the 1960s. Very interesting story. There is a powerful popular liberation movement in Oman, and the current monarchy of Oman was basically created by the British to short-circuit this left-wing radical liberation movement that was about to liberate the country, in order to make sure that they would be able to maintain their rule. Declassified UK has done some amazing work about the closeness of the two. But no, you're right. You see, all the royal families in the Middle East are also tight with the British monarchy, you know, the Hashemite kings in Jordan.
They owe their existence. They owe their existence to the British. I mean, through, like, the Saudi Arabia, and I mean, all these royal families, like, are basically related to each other in one way or another. Through these royal families, through these Gulf monarchies, like, is how the British and then the U.S. both together. And then, of course, the U.S. kind of, like, took over the mantle after the British Empire.
Stopped being really the empire, right? It really is amazing the amount of revisionist history. And, you know, the people saying this is, I saw someone who I follow from Nigeria say in response to somebody on, I think, Good Morning Britain, they were just like, well, if now's not the time to talk about this, when is the time? Like, when the whole world is focused on British imperial, like, history and pageantry, it seems like it's actually the best time to say something about the crimes of what they did. And the other times, you'll just ignore it. So it's the only time in the Western world, or at least in the Anglo-American world, in which you can get a word in edgewise. And before a mass audience on these issues, we think, you know, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, Sri Lanka, you know, all these amazing countries with amazing people and histories and cultures that, you know, I mean, I hate to say it like this, but let's just be honest. When British people were essentially living in little hovels, didn't even know anything about, you know, advanced civilization. There were great, large civilizations in these areas that people couldn't imagine. And when the British first get there to all these places, they're like, wow, this is amazing. These people are doing all these, you know, amazing things. And so we've got to rob and kill and steal them. I mean, it really is, you know, the British Museum, you know, and all half the stuff in there completely stolen. So, yeah, to me, this is actually a great moment in
the
a way. Because
time.
The queen the dying is like, great. So now we can talk about the reality. And we're going to have more to say about this as we go through the show, because quite frankly, we could touch almost every region of the earth and discuss the crimes of the British Empire. And that's just one of the empires that, you know, was doing these things. But yeah, really, really notable. But we'll return to this subject, this topic, later in the show.
Yeah, stay with us, guys. We have a lot more coming about the crimes of the British Empire.
But we want to talk about an important story that did happen while we were out doing various different fantastic things here to make breakthrough news bigger, and that is the referendum on the Constitution in Chile. And we are very happy to be joined by Patricio Zambrano, who is a political analyst and director at the Council on Hemispheric Affairs. Patricio, thank you so much for being with us.
Hey, Bea, how are you guys? It's a real pleasure.
No, the pleasure is all ours. Thank you so much. There's a lot to say here, I think, in terms of the referendum. You know, maybe my first question is, I think a lot of people were surprised to see the result of the constitutional referendum, because it seemed like, you know, the vote to even have a new constitutional process seemed to have so much energy behind it, so much liveliness behind it, that I think a lot of us, myself included, thought maybe it was a little bit of a fait accompli. So maybe you could just give us some basic sense of why the Constitution, this draft of the Constitution, was rejected by those who did show up to vote.
Sure, this is very interesting. Of course, all of us were very, very surprised, although most of the polls actually said that the rejection of the new constitution was going to happen, some of them with certain degree of difference, but at the end of the day, it was exactly what the surveys were saying. And everybody was very, very suspicious about polls, because we have to remember that in the previous elections, polls failed a lot. So, for example, Boric, the new president, he won with a difference of almost 10 points, even though certain polls were saying that both candidates, the extreme right and Boric, were tied. So that was totally crazy how polls didn't get it right. In this case, just for all the people who are watching us right now, the election that Sunday was not the same electoral population that actually voted before. We have to remember a couple of years ago, the option to create a new constitution was accepted by almost 80% of the population. 8 out of 10 Chileans said we want a new constitution. Then a new General Assembly was created, I'm sorry, a constitutional assembly was created. 154 deputies were elected democratically, and the left controlled more than 70% of that assembly. But then we have this referendum where the vote was mandatory. In the previous two elections, the vote was not mandatory. So what happened with that? 6 million new votes were exercised. 6 million. In a way that the distribution of power and the distribution of will was totally affected, was distorted. So that's why we have people who were forced to vote, people who didn't participate in the previous elections. We didn't know their opinions. That doesn't take any legitimacy because it's the vote. It is the photography of the moment. But that's a good explanation why we have this surprise quotation mark that Sunday. It was because of that.
That's actually very interesting. And I'm also curious, you know, when it comes to Chile, I imagine there's a right-wing media apparatus that probably also played a role in trying to demonize the idea of this new constitution. So I'm curious what role the media may have played and the right wing in Chile may have played in pushing against this. As well as, you know, we've also heard or seen, at least, I don't know if this portrayal is accurate, but it's commonly portrayed that as Gabriel Boric having like a very low approval rating. And, it, you know, he's also, you know, his sort of ascension is attached to the idea of a new constitution. So I'm curious, you know, the role of the right-wing media, as well as did the like less popularity of Gabriel Boric play a role in contributing to a rejection of this change in constitution?
Yes, and in some way, unfortunately for Boric, this election, this referendum was perceived as a way of approving or rejecting his government. And that's a mistake, because this process actually was created before Boric became president. We have to remember that the whole social unrest in Chile, with dozens of dead people, hundreds of injured people, people who lost their eyes. I'm not sure if people remember that the police in Chile actually targeted the eyes of people. So we have around between 100 and 200 people with injuries, variation of injuries in their eyes, in a horrific repression that took place under the right-wing Piñera government. So that process started there. Then Boric, his mandate was to go ahead and organize this assembly and the writing of a new constitution. And in fact, yes, his approval rate is low. Chile's been, like in the US, is strongly affected by inflation right now. We have a lot of issues after COVID. The situation that inspired this whole historic movement is still there. Education is still privatized. The health system is still privatized. The pension system is still privatized. The salaries are suffering. So the conditions are exactly the same. And the population, there's no doubt that actually felt that Boric was also responsible for that. So, and Boric didn't do a good job separating himself from the state. He's the government, but he's not the state in the sense of the contract between Chilean citizens and the figure, the symbol of the state. And that contract is broken. We need a new contract, and this new constitution is extremely important. And we need to remember that those needs that inspired the movement are still there. What people rejected was a particular text. A text, I want to add to your analysis, a text that was extremely complicated. We have 388 articles. Compare that to the American Constitution, the U.S. Constitution, which is not a model at all, but at least it's a constitution that you can handle, that you can communicate. In this constitution, this draft had 50,000 words. Extremely, it took me a day to read it myself. So imagine for the rest of the population. So it was a constitution so complex, so full of excellent rights, but also a lot of things that were left very ambiguous. it was very, very hard to defend. It was very hard to communicate to the population. And the right wing media, of course, I mean, used absolutely all full power to discredit the constitution. And actually, just a little anecdote, I was interviewed actually by CNN, and they were very interested in what happened there. And the rest of panelists, they talk immediately about the dirty campaign in Chile of the right. I mean, it was exactly what happened, a very dirty campaign where they distorted a lot of positive elements of the new constitution, and they created fear. And we can talk about that a little bit later.
No, I think that's a very important point, and I did want to speak to that because I think that's some of the things that I was certainly seeing is in the sort of demagogy around, you know, what the right-wing media was saying. For instance, the fact the Constitution was talking about a plurinational state and, you know, the way that was being manipulated to make people think it was something that it's not. So talk about that a little bit, the fear they were able to induce, because it does seem, it reminded me honestly a lot of so much of the presidential campaigns we see in Latin America where they'll just, you know, use the phrase Castro Chavismo and try to raise these boogeymen of how your life is going to be ended the next day if you vote for these people. So talk a little bit about the fear that they created through this campaign in a lot of voters.
Yes, and it's very interesting what I was saying about the CNN interview, because it surprised me the fact that a lot of all the panelists that tend to be more on the establishment side, they were very aware of the dirty campaign, and that surprised me. That means that the campaign was really so strong that was actually perceived by everyone outside of Chile. And the situation was very clear. We have two or three elements that actually created fear. One of them was the rights of indigenous people, basically. We have to remember that the Mapuche people have been affected strongly. They are being affected by a security law that treat them as terrorists. And actually it's a state-sponsored terrorism, the one that is affecting them, and they are victims of violence. They are exercising violence also in the last years, trying to, in a desperate situation, to recover land that belonged to them. So the new constitution was very clear that they were going to have certain autonomy. They were going to have certain rights to have their own justice system. The declaration of respect of religious beliefs and values was written there very, very strongly. And then the right-wing media, through the traditional media outlets, social media channels, et cetera, they created this idea that the new constitution was going to create a state, an indigenous state inside the Chilean state. So that was the view that was painted. And of course, a big population of Chile, it is moderate, it is conservative, and they didn't like that. And the other factor was due to the repression, first under the dictatorship of Augusto Pinochet, later by the military police, because in Chile, the police has a military style, a military education. Because of the repression, it's been so bad that the new constitution responded to that need, and they declared that the state or the government didn't have the right to declare emergency in a way that the security forces could use to repress the Chilean people. That was extremely clear in the new constitution. Well, the right-wing media said, transformed that in the fact that the new constitution was going to create an environment for free crime, basically, that the police was not going to be able to act, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, we had the same issues like in the US, abortion. Abortion was a big issue for a lot of conservative people. So we have two things here. I want to be very, very clear in the analysis. We have a situation where a dirty campaign affected the vote strongly, but of course, we also have 60% of the vote. I mean, it was important. And at the same time, we have several rights that were extremely important for the Chilean future. So it's a combination of those factors.
And I guess, you know, what happens next? Is it over? Is it like the opportunity for a new constitution is finished? Do they go back to the drawing board and try to do something and then people vote on it again? What's like, where does Chile go from here?
That's the biggest question. I mean, everybody is wondering what's gonna happen, because this result was so surprised that the temporary law that authorized this new process of writing a new constitution didn't include any measurements to create an alternative if the draft was going to be rejected. So basically, we don't have a legal path to do this. So then we have to do a political path. So what President Boris did the very first minute after the rejection was funded by the vote, he said, okay, we need to write a new constitution right away. So he called the political parties. He made some changes in his cabinet. We have people closer to the traditional structure of political parties that's actually needed. It's very clear. So what Boris is going to do first is going to negotiate through Congress, through the political parties, and then we're going to eventually create a new effort. And that mechanism is key, because the extreme right are saying we just need a group of experts, and a group of experts should write the constitution. And Boris, and I still believe 80% or 60% or 70%, the majority of Chileans, they want to participate. I think it's really non-realistic to believe that after the whole mobilization, beautiful expression, especially the young people, the young Chilean community was extremely depressed last week because of this. So there are expectations. And the right-wing parties, at least, were very clear that they want to be part of that. They want to be part of a new constitution. They know that they have some leverage now. So what they want to do now is to participate in a more active way. So they're open to write a new constitution. So we are in the middle of negotiations right now. This week, Boris had a very important meeting with most of the parties, except the Republican Party. It's the same name. The Republican Party, which is a new party, very extreme on the right, they are not part of this new effort. So even the right-wing leaders are calling them, please, come to the table, let's discuss this. So that's the future negotiation, and eventually we need to write a new constitution.
Mm-hmm. Well, excuse me. Patricio Zamorano with the Council on Hemispheric Affairs, really appreciate you joining us here on the Freedom Side and helping us sort all this out.
Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure. Mm-hmm.
Well, Rania, we're just going to keep the movement moving on here. Turning back to the crimes of empire, we turn now to Kenya, and we are very honored to be joined here on our show by Booker Omole, who is the National Vice Chairperson and National Organizing Secretary of the Communist Party of Kenya. Booker, thank you so much for being with us here on the show.
Thank you very much, Eugene, and it's a pleasure to meet you again and Rania today. Especially at this historic moment when we are, looking at the so-called legacy of the Queen. Yeah.
You know, I tell you, the pleasure is all ours. And yeah, the legacy, it's interesting to me because so much of the conversation is like, at least in the United States, well, maybe the Queen or maybe the British did something wrong, but it wasn't when the Queen was around. But some of the biggest crimes of the British Empire in the history of the British Empire, but certainly in the African continent, took place in Kenya when she was the Queen. And I was hoping you could just talk about that, because I think that's a history, you know, of the Land and Freedom Army and others that is just unknown to most Americans, especially the brutality of the British.
Yes, so first of all, probably the Kenyan people and the Kenyan masses view the death of the Queen, you know, as a painful reminder of the atrocities that Kenya continue to suffer to date. Because sometimes we focus on the colonial, but then we also have the neocolonial system and the same policy and the same system still reigns in Kenya today. So in terms of the colonial era, then it was brutal repression, massive exploitation of, you know, the natural resources and super exploitation of almost, you know, free labor that the Kenya as a country offered. But in our perspective from the Communist Party of Kenya, we should not only look at it from the death of the queen, because the death of the queen is not enough. The monarch system got to fall, and it will not fall by its own. You know, it has to be pushed. It has to be fought to fall. So we cannot be sitting here waiting for the death of the queen or the death of Henry Kissinger and all these, you know, filthy capitalists that has continued to ravage the, you know, the continent of Africa. So in 1957, which is the most, you know, historic event, that the, under the signature of the queen, you know, the our freedom fighter, Field Marshal Dedan Kimathi, was even killed, murdered, and his body to date has never been recovered, you know. Even the Queen himself and the entire British government has never admitted any of those, you know, atrocities that they committed in Kenya. And in fact, they have continued to act as if everything, you know, is normal. There is a big campaign now in our country that we want to give Dedan Kimathi, you know, a decent burial. We want to put him, you know, in the beacon of history as a beacon of hope of our people, our young people. And several things still, you know, meander in our mind when we see these misreactions, especially from the head of state and the Kenyan government, in terms of issuing statements on the so-called the legacy of the queen. And it has exposed several things for us here in our country. For example, in terms of issues of land, which still stands in our country today, land is at the center of the struggle and was at the center of the struggle of the freedom. And I hear some people try to praise the king, the queen, of having managed a peaceful transition from the colonial, you know. And I thought that's silly, childish talk, because in fact, after the British actually lost the war for independence, they opted to negotiate to end up with a sham independence to actually favor the white settler, you know, land, big land owners in our country. So, in fact, to say that she even tried to have a peaceful transition, it's like dancing on the, you know, on the graves of the poor people that, you know, had been murdered during that period. So when we had, you know, and this just shows how the Kenyan population is ahead of their government and ahead of their political leaders in terms of political consciousness. Because there can only be two things that happens when people are eulogizing the queen. First of all, is that the Kenyan government or the Kenyan politicians, who are still, you know, an appendage of the British system that benefits from alms, of course, then will not want to sever that relationship. So they indeed said and, you know, talked positive things about the queen, or say that out of respect they had to say certain things, especially when they're cornered. But for us who are determined for you know, a total liberation of our country, we have no privilege to celebrate the life of a colonizer for something that she has not even admitted. That sometimes here when we are in debates, you know, people ask that if my grandfathers oppressed you, what should I do? Or probably the easiest answer will be kill yourself if you cannot recognize that you're still benefiting from the same, you know, atrocities that was committed by your grandparents. And if that could be the case, then in our own perspective, we see several things that brings out how even our education system has been interfered with to rewrite our history and then bring out the British, colonial British as the victors. Because you see, even in the oppressed stratas of the Kenyan society, we could see some elements of Christian fundamentalist or members of the Anglican Church celebrating the death of the Queen and wishing her to stay well in heaven, you know, with the angels. But in actual sense, what basically that one reveals is how deeply the Kenyan education system has been attacked by the former colonial to try and rewrite histories and, of course, vilify, call the victims the perpetrators, and on the other side, even call the perpetrators, the victims of such atrocities. And we could see even the name they gave to our freedom fighter, Dedan Kimathi. They called him a terrorist, and for a long time he was in the British terrorist list until we redeemed his image, and now he's an epitome of hope for our people.
You know, Booker, it's so interesting to me how in so many parts of the developing world, whether we're talking about the Middle East or Africa, or we're talking about India earlier, the debate or the controversy or these attitudes exist among the people, the class of people in the country who like collaborated with the British or still benefit as like the capitalist class. I'm just curious, in Kenya, it sounds like there's been that back and forth where there's like a segment of people in Kenya who are like, who have like a sort of nostalgia for the Queen and the British, and then there's everybody else. Do these dynamics exist across other parts of Africa as well? I mean, the crimes of the British obviously were very extreme in Kenya, but certainly not isolated there in terms of the continent of Africa.
Yeah, you see, the Queen, for a fact, represents a small minority, of people that continues to be, parasites on the back of the working class. And for the Queen to actually, or the monarch system in British, to perfect their exploitation of the African people, they have to find their own stooges. They have to find their own puppets. They have to find, for lack of a better word, they are dogs to manipulate in Africa. So indeed, the oppressor would not have been so powerful if he did not have collaborators among the oppressed class. So for example, in Kenya, we have the Comprado Bourgeoisie, we have the National Bourgeoisie that sees themselves as brokers of the big metropolis. And there, for a fact, they see the establishment of the monarch system as an end to how they continue to exploit the Kenyan people. For example, here in our country, we still have the Batuk, the British military, that is stationed here to protect any dictator that rises to power. That in the event that people there is violence, riots, or an opposition to the state, then the British army will step in to support the local army. And this has been gave up to a string of military bases in Kenya. So the group of the sellouts, the parasitic class here, try to find narratives to justify reasons why they need to celebrate the Queen. But the people who have suffered the oppressive system or the repressive system of colonialism and neocolonialism can never forget those moments, because it is real to them. It's not just about stories that continue to be told. For a fact, we've had, for example, people in the tourist sector, coming up with stories like, the monarch system and the Queen is a big attraction of our country. And every time a prince comes to Nairobi, then we are on the map. Such justification just show how bankruptcy of ideas this parasitic class holds. Because for them, if any relationship benefits them, they do not care about every other person. So there are indeed the classes of the former home guards, that actually collaborated with the British system, with the British colonizers to brutalize their own people, those people must continue to advance a narrative that a better one, you know, is better with the Queen, who then, the Queen Mama of the British never goes wrong. Her word measured to protect the stolen wealth from the South. And we can continue to highlight certain things that, for example, if you look at even the democracy, in actual sense, the monarch system brings out the hypocrisy of the British democracy. Because how do you have an elected leader reigning for all that time, and then it's passed on from one son to the other, as if there is, there is some scientific evidence that wisdom could be passed from father to son, and in that way. Even in our revolutionary movements, we don't care whether you are the son of who, but you have to build your credentials as the love of people. But you cannot say just because I was son, for example, of Dedan Kimathi, therefore I am a freedom fighter. But we have to then look at the monarch system in Britain as just a small decaying class that is trying to maintain and influence satraps among the ruling class of the Southern Hemisphere or of the poor countries. So for a fact, I agree with you totally that the collaborating class in Kenya would like to take the Kenyan masses out of reality. And it is our duties as revolutionaries to continue to remind them that fact will never forget the atrocities that are committed by the colonial power, Imperial Britain, in our country. And if they do want us to do that, then they should come openly and delink themselves from that dirty past and hand over the wealth. In fact, bring the wealth and all the artifacts that were stolen from our country and give a public apology so that we start a honest relationship based on solidarity, mutual interest, and love for our people. In that way, then we could say that we are ready to start and open a new page. But if you still continue to interfere with our internal affairs, you continue even to determine our policies through the loaning system, force upon austerity measures, then how is it possible that such a people can forget, how you murdered or raped their parents, robbed their dignity? It's impossible, for the African people to even think of, forgiving the queen. For it's an education more the Kenyan masses. That the death of the queen is not enough. Even if the queen dies, but the monarch remains in place. The president of Kenya dies today, but the colonial system remains. Even Obama went, but Trump came in. Now we have Joe Biden there. The system, the capitalist system continues to entrench itself, and a few minority continue to get resources for only themselves and subjugating the rest of the population into poverty.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I very well said, and I think a good summary of where we are and what the legacy does, what the legacy means or should mean for people's movements around the world. Booker Omole from the Communist Party of Kenya, thank you so much for giving us some of your time here on the Freedom Side.
Thank you very much, and I hope to talk to you more often, and good work you're doing to bring the left perspective, away from this corporate manufactured propaganda to turn our brains upside down.
Right on, okay. Right on. We will definitely talk again soon. Much appreciation to you, my brother. Well, Rania, I want to just keep moving here into, another country that, of course, has been, victimized so significantly here over many, many years as it concerns British imperialism. That is Ireland. One that I think, unfortunately, people don't think enough about. We are very happy to be joined here by Eugene McCartan, who's the General Secretary of the Communist Party of Ireland. It's got a great name, too. Eugene, thank you so much for being with us.
Good afternoon or good evening, whichever it is.
Well, you know, I wanted to start here. I think a lot of people in the United States, especially, who don't know much about the history of Ireland, don't even really think of Ireland as a victim of British imperialism. So I was hoping to actually start there, if you could give us just some context of how the British Empire has over the years, you know, attacked and subjugated the Irish people.
That's should never ask an Irish person about history, because you have to have about 3 or 4 hours here at your disposal. So, and to list the crimes of British imperialism in Ireland. So, briefly, I suppose for the past 600-700 years, the Irish people have experienced the occupation and colonialism of the neighbouring island of Britain. And in that period of time, many of the policies, instruments of repression, mechanisms of control that the British applied across the empire were first practiced in Ireland. They were first road tested to see how effective they were and how useful they would be. And the tactic has always been primarily at the very bottom. The bottom line has always been divide and rule. And that has been the characteristic of the British Empire right across the world, is of divide and rule. Whether it be in Ireland from the using religion, whenever religion was a potent force in people's lives, using religion as a weapon of division, to food, when the Great Famine, when half the population were virtually starved to death or left the country, food was used as a weapon, land was used as a weapon. So we've all had those practiced upon the people of Ireland by the British. That has continued up to this day, that divisions in the north is somewhat, they would use the terms, the British present themselves as being the arbitrators, the referees between two warring religious factions. That masks their political role, their economic role, their military role, that the divisions in the north of Ireland are not about what church you go to or what religion or what way you interpret the Bible. It's about where democracy must lie. Those from the nationalist republican tradition believe that national democratic unitary state is the way in which they can secure their rights, whereas loyalism, unionism, believes that it is they can only find protection within the confines with or under the umbrella of or the patronage of being linked to British imperialism. So it's not about religion, it's about where the destiny of the people lies. And the British cleverly play their religious card to sustain and maintain their own political and economic interests in the north of Ireland, thereby the rest of Ireland. So the royal family, I've tried to avoid it for the last 5 or 6 days, to be honest, but it's almost impossible. That all newspapers in Ireland and news television, while we're nominally a republic here in the south in Dublin, there is a tremendous amount of fawning over the royal family, over the Queen, very apologetic about having to express any sort of questions about Irish history and the role the British played, and whether it be the suppression of the 1916 rising, the violence inflicted upon the people during the War of Independence, the subsequent promotion of this the war against Republicans who wished to push forward for the ending to prevent partition of Ireland. So the British have had an active hand in all those situations. And I just noted your comment from Kenya. I mean, all those policies and everything else have all been tried, whether it be in Malaya, Kenya, South Africa. I mean, the Boers, the concentration camps were first developed by the British in South Africa. So it's these are all historical things. The Burma and wherever else they've been, India, in China. I mean, they talk about the war on drugs today in Latin America. The British went to war twice against the Chinese over the Opium Wars. So it's say they have a war against drugs when it suits them and a war against drugs when it doesn't suit them. But today, I think what the royal, but the whole idea about the royalty, I think which is most important thing, it is about the justification of class and class privilege. It's about reinforcing that dominant narrative. There are people who are born to be to rule and to govern. Then there, and there are those who are governed. And I think that is saying, I mean, to that is whether that's so it's about reinforcing this concept of a class divided society as being normal, natural. And it is the order of things. It is the order of things. And I think that's where we have to deal with this question. It is about it is this approach that it is about justification of privilege, a justification of class, of a class society. I know in the United States, they try to mask this idea that there is no class within the United States. But obviously, there clearly is. And that is why the United States is so infatuated by this death of this parasitic element in London, because it is there if the ruling elite of the bankers and financiers of Wall Street or of all the other sort of hedge funds and everything else, if they could establish a royalty, they would do it. But it's not at this moment in time possible. The material conditions are not there, but they have the same class distinctions. They have the same class belief that they are better than everybody else, that everybody else is subservient and to their needs and interests, and everybody is to be used to advance their needs and interests. And so the royalties are about reinforcing that, that old, as they would call it here in Ireland, the relic of all decency, the relic of feudalism that is the royalty.
Yeah, I think like from everything you just said, I think what the important takeaway is, as we discuss all of the sort of crimes of British Empire around the world, is that it's all still relevant today. Like it's not just something that happened in history that we're remembering because it's important to remember when bad things happen in history. It's the way that it still matters today. So I'm just curious, could you just very briefly like explain how the crimes of the British Empire in Ireland are still relevant to Ireland today?
Well, they are still very much so. We've just come out of a period of armed conflict between the Irish Republican Army, the IRA, and the British state. We've seen witnessed many, many atrocities from Bloody Sunday to the Ballymurphy massacre. We've seen internment where hundreds of people were arrested without trial. We have seen the shoot-to-kill policy, which are basically is state-directed killings, the state collusion with loyalist paramilitaries and the state-directed killings. There's all of those things, and all of them, you see the royal families walking their walking in the parades, following the coffin, bearing their military uniforms of their regiments, which they are the heads of. That would be the parachute regiments and various other regiments. So they are part and parcel of what was the British system of oppression in the six counties in the north of Ireland. They're part and parcel of that whole British apparatus that still continues to exist. The military intelligence operations that still exist and take place every day of the week in the north of Ireland, in Belfast and Derry and other such places. And we also remember that queen that we were talking about, she was actually responsible for the dismissing of the Australian government in early 1970s. The Wolf Whitman government was dismissed by the Queen, by the Privy Council, because they didn't like his politics. They didn't like his policies that he was implementing in Australia. And the same goes for Diego Garcia, the military base. The people there had won a case preventing it by their island being taken over by both US and British armed forces. And the Privy Council basically overruled the decisions, and those people lost their homeland. So this is not something which is in the relic in the past. This is something which is real, meaningful, has real power and has real substance. And when the British state itself goes into crisis, the Privy Council, the Queen, the aristocracy, all come into play as a stabilizing factor in these processes. So it's not something something which goes back into the past. It is ever present. It is ever influential. And as I say, it's about reinforcing the dominant narrative that privilege of class division, of exploitation, and of, and to a degree, white power in Britain. And that's what it is. And that's the one of the fracture lines within that royal family, is the deep racism that exists within them. Because they have existed based upon the super exploitation of the empire and the dominion and the demonization of those who whom they colonized, whom they believed were inferior, either in color, religion, or whatever else, or by birth. That there's a whole sense of superiority that oozes out of the pores of these people on a daily basis.
No, I think that's very, very well taken point of really all the points, but certainly that last one I think is so key in the reinforcement of class privilege. I appreciate that perspective. Well, Eugene McCartan, Communist Party of Ireland, really appreciate you giving us some of your time. I know it's late over there. Here on the
Thank you very much. No problem. Thank you.
Yeah, shout out to a lot of our guests today. It's very late. India, Kenya, Ireland. So I really appreciate folks sticking with us. Communistparty.ie. If you want to get in on what the communists are doing over there in Ireland, I think you will thank me later. A lot of great analysis about a number of points there. But I thought that was actually a really good point, Rania, that Eugene, and I'm not saying it because his name is Eugene, made about how sort of the way the monarchy is used to sort of give this sense that some people are born to rule and some people are born to be ruled. I had never really looked at it that way. I think that's a really interesting commentary on that.
Oh, absolutely. And I do have to say it is not to take away from the important point you just emphasized, but it is fun to hear you say Eugene, because for a moment I'm like, is he talking about himself in the third person?
But listen, yeah. There's not too many of us out here, but we do tend to be very sharp, you know, and very historically minded people. So again, thanks to Eugene McCartan, General Secretary of the Communist Party of Ireland. We're now going to move to another very, very important story here in the United States, and that is in Jackson, Mississippi, the poison water crisis there. A lot of challenges with water. We have Danielle Holmes, national organizer with the Poor People's Campaign and a Jackson, Mississippi resident with us. Danielle, thank you so much for joining us here on the Freedom Side.
Thank you for having me.
Well, I'll tell you, the pleasure is all ours. I mean, in a way, I wish we didn't have to be having this conversation about this very point. But one thing I want to delve into here that I think is important, and just reading the news about what happened, is how did we get to this point in Jackson? I mean, I've heard, you know, you hear that there's a flood and that was the proximate cause, but there's so many people kind of passing the buck. You know, who's really responsible and how did we get here?
A good question. And then I just want to acknowledge, you know, today the governor of the state of Mississippi lifted the boil water notice, which was a very dangerous move to the residents of Jackson. And this is what has been going on for decades. Neglect, no real concern for those who are living here in the capital city. Extreme racist politics have hijacked our city, have hijacked our state, and lives are in danger now. And so what you're getting from me today, I'm very emotional right now. Because our lives are at stake. And to rush to lift a boil water notice when we know that even before this water crisis, the water in Jackson wasn't safe, right? This is decades of neglect, decades of refusal from our state government and federal government to allocate resources here to the city of Jackson, the capital city of Mississippi, by which is the poorest state in this country. Resources to fix its infrastructure. And this is not just happening in the city of Jackson. It's happening all across the state of Mississippi in rural areas and poor and low wealth communities.
You mentioned it was not, the water was already dirty before, because this suddenly became a national story in the last couple of weeks, I think. But what was the situation before a couple of weeks ago, and why did this suddenly become a national story if the water was already so terrible?
So we, this is not our first rodeo with national attention on Jackson's water crisis, right? We just had national attention in 2020 during the winter storm, when everything was shut down here. And folks can even get out, even if they wanted to get out to get clean water. And so, but what you're seeing now is a real failure. All the Band-Aids that have been coming off, you know, of open wounds, of issues that have been happening here around the water crisis. The other night, I was sitting in a community meeting, and I learned during that meeting that Jackson, the city of Jackson's water treatment, the infrastructure is one of the most complex built infrastructures that engineers have ever seen before, right? They talked about you have a membrane and then you have a conventional system. And so you have these two systems trying to work together. And experts are saying this was bound to happen. And it could have happened long before now, but grace was on our side. But at this point, all of our grace has run out. And so everything has hit the fan. So we have to go back and even begin to question from the time that Jackson's infrastructure was built, was it built in a correct manner? You know,
yeah.
Was the OB Curtis treatment water facility really built in a way that will be able to sustain the citizens of Jackson getting clean water?
You know, I think this is such an important point on so many different levels, and I'm glad you raised the, you know, the lack of resources that have been sent to Jackson, and not only the lack of resources, but the just racist paternalism. You know, I know the governor's tried to say there needs to be some, you know, you can only give them money if you give them oversight, which, you know, we know what that means. Sad to say, I quite frankly, Congressman Benny Thompson saying something similar recently, which I have to say I was very disappointed to see. I mean, it almost seems like one of the key elements of what the state government and the federal government is trying to do with this crisis is make sure the crisis remains so that they can take advantage of these moments to try to take away the home rule of Jackson residents.
Absolutely. And what we're seeing is you know, you have elected officials, and I'm not here to slam any individual, but I am here to hold all elected officials accountable, right? And so they've sat silent during these issues, all of them, right? And when Jackson was pleading for help, no one showed up. But yet we could talk about, but you show up to talk about privatizing the city of Jackson's water. It makes you question what's at the table, what's at stake for you, right? The first thing you do, the first conversation, instead of talking about solutions, the most immediate concern is privatization. That's a problem. And especially when you have stake in this community. If you own businesses in this community, if you have loved ones in this community, if you live 10 miles outside of this community, you are complicit in what has happened with the city of Jackson and the governor and the federal government as well. So we have to begin to talk about this. It doesn't matter if you're Democratic or Republican, brown, black, or white. We are all impacted by this water crisis, and it is unsafe for all of us that live here in the city of Jackson.
So I'm curious, like, in the meantime, obviously, this water is not drinkable. The images we're seeing, it doesn't look like it can even be used to, like, bathe oneself right now. So are people just completely dependent on purchasing bottled water? Is there any help in order to get clean water? Because obviously that costs money that people don't often have to just be spending on bottled water. Like, what are people doing to get by? This is such an important resource you literally cannot live without.
So as we're seeing, MEMA is pulling out. National Guards that have been distributing water, they're shutting down their sites. But we, the Mississippi Rapid Response Coalition, who has partnered with the city of Jackson, we've been on the ground from day one. For the last 2 years, we've been ensuring that folks will get clean, and clean and safe water. We've doubled down on our efforts even now, right? And we're going to push the message that Jackson water isn't clean until it meets all of EPA standards and not just a few. And so we're distributing, we have 6 distribution sites. We're doing door-to-door delivery. We're canvassing. We're going to put the message out there. We're creating our own narrative, a narrative that is true, a narrative that says that lead was in Jackson's water before the water crisis. Lead will continue to be in Jackson's water until Jackson's overhaul and rebuild its infrastructure.
You know, I think that's a really good point that you made about the infrastructure, because it feels, you know, almost like that's almost beside the point. I mean, I see some of these numbers and people say, well, the $42 million this, I've read that it would cost $1 billion to rebuild. I mean, it seems like even in the conversation about money that should be given to Jackson, that the city is still being shortchanged, that a lot of the conversation about what people want to give is still not what's necessary to really get things up to par.
The city, the infrastructure in Jackson has been shortchanged. This administration, the administration prior, the administration prior to that administration, the administration prior to that administration, right? And so, again, we talk about decades of underfunding the city of Jackson, underfunding Jackson's infrastructure, which so happens our state capital sits here. Our governor mansion sits here. Our governor lives here. He goes and purchases filtration systems and have a water tank at the governor's mansion, leaving Jacksonians to battle with no clean water. You can go and visit restaurants. The lieutenant governor had a visit. Lieutenant Governor Deborah Hoseman. You went to go visit restaurants, but not one time has the governor or lieutenant governor been in the community to talk with the residents who are directly impacted. Many of the business owners don't even live here in the city of Jackson.
You know, you mentioned the racial element of this, that these are based on racist policies. Can you break that down for us? Like, who's suffering here?
The population here in the city of Jackson, we are all suffering. But those who are disproportionately impacted are the poor and low wealth communities. So when you look at who's really impacted directly, disproportionately impacted here in the city of Jackson, you look at West Jackson, you look at South Jackson, you know, the largest part that makes up the city of Jackson, right? Those are the individuals who are disproportionately impacted, which is predominantly Black communities, West Jackson and South Jackson. And so this is when you talk about racism, you see that a governor who clearly states his position when it comes to Black folks, when it comes to the poor and low wealth, and when he labels us as liberals, which sometimes, you know, when you read his tweets or what he posts on Facebook, for me, and you all just excuse me, but I have to say this, is that this man is really saying, instead of saying liberals, it's almost as if he's ready to say nigga, right? Mm-hmm. And it's so blatant. But yet, no one has challenged him on his behavior. We have elected officials year after year sit quiet while Republican-led leadership tap dance on our heads. And they do whatever they want to do, and they get away with it. This is why we are in the crisis we're in the city of Jackson, because you have folks like our Governor Tate Reeves who have been made comfortable by people that look like me to disrespect us and to treat us in the manner that they're doing. But we come to break those barriers and to shift the narrative and to tell those who have been sitting at the table for 20 to 30 years, 40, 50 years with no return on our tax dollars, it's time for you to go. The state of Mississippi and the way that business has been run is no more. You have $70 million that was stolen from poor and low wealth. And the wealthy walk away from it. But if I go out and steal $1, I'm going to prison.
You couldn't say it better than that. And you know, for those who haven't been following it, I mean, this scandal with Brett Favre and taking this money and all of that. I mean, I wonder how it feels, or not I wonder, I mean, I'm curious how it feels to see this playing out at the same time where you have this, you know, obviously world famous figure in Brett Favre essentially colluding with the government to steal this money to build a volleyball court for the University of Southern Mississippi. And he's not even criminally charged. I mean, he's in every story, not even criminally charged. I'm ranting now, but I just wonder how it feels to see these two things playing out, you know, alongside each other, you know, as a Jackson resident.
Well, but not only was Brett Favre wasn't charged, our former governor, Phil Bryant, who text message shows that he was direct, he's the head ringleader of this whole scam. He hasn't been charged, right? Neither has he been implicated in any civil suit. We have to ask the question why. And why this is racism. This is systemic racism, structural racism. Every form of racism is at play here in the state of Mississippi. This just didn't start happening. It has been going on. And we have to keep in mind Mississippi just abolished slavery in 2016. So their mindset that individuals, poor and low wealth, or anybody who are beneath them are not a part of their cult, we are their slaves. And this is how they create policies. This is how they talk demeaning to us, to the point even that Black folks were made to feel bad just for wanting water in the lines that where Mima was giving out water. A woman was really ridiculed and told that she can go to Walmart and purchase water simply because she needed to pick up water for her disabled elderly neighbors. This is wrong. This is immoral, and it has to stop.
Well, Danielle, before we let you go, I just wanted to ask, I know there's probably a lot of people wondering if there's a way they can support the efforts you all have there in Jackson on the ground, organizing with the masses.
So we're definitely organizing, and if there's ever time to go to war, it's time to go to war now here in the state of Mississippi. We're having Moral Monday in Mississippi with our the National Poor People's Campaign, our co-chair, Reverend Barber, William Barber II, and Reverend Liz Theo Harris will be here in Jackson, Mississippi. We will march on this state. We will lift up the voices of those directly impacted. This is not a stage for status quo CEOs or organization presidents, but this is a platform for those who are directly impacted by this water crisis in the city of Jackson, and to tell their story and to tell how they've been overlooked, neglected, ridiculed, and told to pull themselves up by their boots.
Well, Danielle Holmes from the Poor People's Campaign, also of Jackson, Mississippi, really, really appreciate you giving us some of your time here on the Freedom Side.
Thank you all so much.
And shout out to Reverend Liz from the Poor People's Campaigns. Done a lot to support us here at Breakthrough News over the couple years we've been around. I don't know. We always say these things are unbelievable. Yeah. Sadly, they like are not unbelievable, but they are still so outrageous to see. I mean, allegedly the richest country, you know, on earth. And here we are, you know, people can't, 190,000 people in Jackson, Mississippi can't even drink their water, can't bathe. You know, anything.
You know, I was, when she was talking about restaurants and the governor's mansion having their own filtration systems and these sorts of things, it reminds me of like the way a country like Lebanon functions, which has no state, by the way. Lebanon is like basically has no state. And so it's up to every building, every restaurant, every individual to really deal with like getting their own water, because there's not a proper like functioning system that can deliver, you know, drinkable water to everybody. And I'm just thinking, man, but like, it's like a developing country, you know, that suffered a lot of war and all these other things. Like, what is the excuse inside the United States, the richest country in the world, to have areas like this that actually are living like the way that Lebanon is living? And so it doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah.
No, not that that's really okay that Lebanon's living that way, but again, no state.
No, of
Lebanon,
course.
So,
right. Yeah, it's a glaring... glaring disparity. Well, we want to turn now to the Horn of Africa, where sadly conflict has continuing here, has flared back up. But we are very honored to be joined by the Ethiopian American journalist and organizer with the No More Movement and friend of Breakthrough News, Hermela Aurgawi. Hermela, thank you so much for joining us here on the show.
Thanks for having me. Hey, Eugene and Rania.
Good to see you or hear you again. We had a great Twitter space last night hosted by Hermela. Thank you for that again. You know, Hermela, it's always difficult to know where to start here in some ways, because I think, you know, some of us who are covering this and following this so much, we're so deep into it. But I think for a lot of people, they just sort of see these sort of fleeting glimpses, you know, across the headlines of bad things happening in Ethiopia. And sadly, that's kind of a meme in American media. So before we get too deep into it, I mean, what is actually going on here in northern Ethiopia in this conflict? I mean, is it a humanitarian crisis that the United States is bravely trying to prevent, or is there something else taking place?
You know, something that your last guest on the Mississippi water issue, Daniel Holmes, said actually was a really good description of where the Horn of Africa is when it comes to this conflict with insurgents fighting the federal government. She said the people of Mississippi have run out of grace. I think it's fair to say that the people of Ethiopia and Eritrea and the larger Horn have actually run out of grace in this conflict. It is not a humanitarian issue the way that it's painted by Western media. It's simply an insurgency, the TPLF insurgents who were in power for 27 years, so they're more powerful than your average insurgents. The TPLF has been fighting the federal government for now the last almost 2 years. They started the war by attacking National Defense Forces in November 2020, and they continue to use the people of Tigray to fight this war to get back into power, which is really a horrible miscalculation. The majority of that region, more than 120 million people, are familiar with this regime. They have decidedly said they do not want them back. It's an ethno-fascist group made up of some members from the ethnic Tigrayan community, but the larger Tigrayan population, which is about 5 or 6 or 7 million, is actually poor. They've been left behind by that regime, and they're actually much better off by the current government of Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed, which has been voted in by the majority of the people, arguably the only democratic election we've ever had, or the closest thing to a democracy that we've had. So the humanitarian issue is actually caused by the TPLF insurgents, but if you look at mainstream media, they make it seem like it's the federal government that's causing the humanitarian crisis. And it's become very clear throughout the 2 years that the federal government has allowed as much aid as it can into that region, almost to a fault. Some might argue they have given too much to that region that is being occupied by the TPLF insurgents. But I think ultimately, the way the federal government is handling it, by giving more than expected and watching the TPLF insurgents continue their war, gives some sort of peace of mind for the people of the Horn, in that we've done all we can. This group is just not going to come to peace.
I'm so happy that you mentioned the mainstream media, Hermela, because as we've talked about with you before, the media coverage of this conflict in the West has just been horrendous. It's been unbelievably one-sided, completely pro-TPLF, zero nuance whatsoever. The government is bad and evil. Like you mentioned, insurgent, glorious rebel group just trying to fight for people's freedom. When in fact, even with something as huge as, I think it was last month, like several UN trucks of fuel were stolen by the TPLF. It was such an outrageous act that the head of, was it the World Food Program? I'm not, you can correct me about who it was, but the head of whatever specific UN organization actually tweeted about it and made a public statement basically condemning the TPLF. I didn't see any media outlets cover it. And the only time I actually have seen Ethiopia in the news as of late is with the latest, sort of attempt by the TPLF to like go on the offensive again. And then of course, now that they're losing, they're asking for a ceasefire. So that's what we're seeing. Anybody who's just seeing the headlines or maybe reading a little bit about Ethiopia, that's what they're seeing in the news right now, is that the TPLF is begging for a ceasefire and the big evil government isn't giving them one. And I know it's hard to give like a play-by-play over what's happened over the past 2 years, but in this recent sort of episode of fighting, can you explain what's actually taken place?
So what's become evidently clear is that the TPLF, with all of its stolen billions of dollars in stolen money from Ethiopia in the last 27 years, is able to buy out the narrative. If there was any confusion, at least for me, in terms of what the mainstream media is and what their job is when it comes to particularly foreign policy issues, it's now become clear to me that whoever has the most money gets to write the narrative. So the TPLF has billions of dollars. The top 10 richest people in that group are, they have billions of dollars each, right? More than $1 billion worth. So they're able to buy these lobby groups that then place their, that have placed journalists in different mainstream media outlets. And they're able to sort of twist the narrative in a way where they can have some sort of deniability. But really, when you look at it, they are choosing to ignore major pieces of news. Like you mentioned, Rania, with last week or 2 weeks ago, it was 500,000 liters of fuel that was stolen by this insurgent group, which, by the way, is designated a terrorist organization by the Ethiopian government. So while they were complaining about not getting enough aid, which for 5 months the Ethiopian government allowed unfettered humanitarian access to that region, while they were complaining about not having fuel, they went around and actually hijacked. They stole more than 500,000 liters from a UN World Food Program post. That's a lot of fuel. That's fuel that could supply a lot of humanitarian aid to all of the people in the Tigray region. So when you look at that as a journalist and think this would be a big news day for every media news outlets if they were interested in actually covering the story properly. But instead, like you said, Rania, you barely saw it anywhere. And the same was true this time last year when humanitarian aid trucks went missing, a total of 1,000 in the end. But in the beginning, when the UN chief of mission in Ethiopia called it out, it was about 500 humanitarian aid trucks. That was around the same time that they were claiming the humanitarian blockade was in place. And when those trucks went missing and that was called out, they said, oh, it was because we didn't have enough fuel. Well, you looked at the numbers about in terms of what UN gave to them in fuel, and they had twice as much fuel to return those trucks. Again, that did not show up in any media outlets. In fact, the BBC pretended to try to answer that question about whether these aid trucks didn't return because of a shortage of fuel, and they pseudo answered it and left people with the conclusion that in fact there wasn't enough fuel, when you really looked at the numbers that they themselves provided, and I reached out to UN OSHA to get a little bit of clarity, it showed there was twice as much fuel. So it's very clear, and I think the TPLF and this conflict has really ruined whatever credibility that is left of the mainstream media outlets, because the lies are super unsophisticated. An example being this week, the TPLF claimed that a drone bombed a Mekelle University campus. Mekelle is the capital of the Tigray region. And the corresponding photo evidence that they showed was three sort of photos of a neighborhood with a little bit of debris here and there, and a man's what looked like his arm with a little bit of just a little, like a large mosquito bite would look like. So that is not believable evidence for a drone bomb on a university campus. Yet, the Reuters straight up said one civilian injured in a drone bomb. That is not an injury from a drone bomb. And this also, I have personal experience with these lies because, as you guys know, my mom was in that region for 2 or 3 months in the beginning of the war. And it's like, on repeat, they just play the tape again. Because this time, I would argue November, when the war started, they said there was an airstrike on a university campus, the same university campus. Of course, I'm freaking out, thinking, my mom actually lives and teaches on that campus. Turns out there was never a targeted strike on that campus. Some sort of debris fell from something, arguably, like it's even unclear what it was. The TPLF could have had something to do with that, because if it's an airstrike, you're going to have more than one person injured. Mm. And so I talked to her once she got out, and she said, there's no way. The campus did not get targeted. If the campus is targeted by an airstrike, there is no campus, right? And so that is those kind of just low-level lies that are being told about this conflict in every media outlet. I mean, I don't know why they don't consider the future in terms of how the people of the Horn of Africa are going to view these outlets. I mean, we're one of many communities that have come to this conclusion with mainstream media outlets, so I don't know how they plan on surviving after this.
You know, I think that's an extraordinarily good point. I mean, honestly, we'd be here all day cataloging the number of lies. I mean, it really, honestly, the more you follow this, the more amazing it is, the just fact-free reporting going on from, you know, so many mainstream journalists, and they believe everything the TPLF says. They don't believe anything anybody else tells them, no matter how well documented. I mean, again, I don't want to go on a rant about this, but I just think that's a critically, critically important point. And yeah, that skinned knee photo is amazing. I mean, you're saying that there's a drone bombing that's killed dozens of people. Well, where are the bodies? I mean, this is an area that you control. You think you'd show a picture. They're claiming in their press releases that they've killed like 100,000 people and no photos. And then there's a false thing circulating of thousands of Ethiopian soldiers taken hostage. Then it comes out that it was actually from 2 years ago. But, you know, you never get that follow-up to do it. But anyway, I don't want to get too sidetracked on the media because I think this is really crucial to understand the dynamics of the Horn of Africa, this conflict, because it seems to me, Hermela, that a huge amount of the impetus here for why the United States has been giving this tacit support to the TPLF through the entire conflict, and certainly we can see it from the TPLF's own rhetoric, is that they as a force in the international community are fearful of the fact that, you know, since 2018, with the new government, we've seen more regional unity between Ethiopia and Eritrea, which has really been historic, quite frankly. Ethiopia and Somalia, you know, which in many ways was also had its own history to it. Inside Ethiopia itself, you know, the rise of a conversation about more unity across the 84 ethnicities that exist in the country. And it really feels that the TPLF was fearful of that, of people coming together across all these various lines, and that the international community was too. And I just wonder if A, you think I'm right in saying that that is the state of affairs, and B, why you think that might be.
Why the TPLF is afraid of everybody coming together in the Horn of Africa?
Yes, if you think that is in fact true.
Well, they've been horrible in leadership, right? When you know you've been abusing a people during the time where you had power, you're going to be afraid to let go. You know, that they could have let up a little bit along the years. You know, in 1991, when they overthrew the communist government at the time and came into power, they were received essentially with open arms because there had been 17 years of war, several opposition groups that were fighting the communist government. You can debate why and how that happened, but ultimately the facts is a lot of people were dying and it was turning into a bloody experiment. So when they overthrew the government in 1991 and came in, they essentially just rode into Addis, right? So even though they were representatives of this minority ethnic group that were built on the idea of liberating this ethnic group, they were supposed to go independent, but somehow they changed their mind and decided to run the whole country. Nonetheless, they were received, and it wasn't really until the 2005 elections and before that, when the war with Eritrea started, that things just really started to go awry and the people started to turn against them. The 2005 elections, there was a lot of organizing that happened among Ethiopians. And yet the TPLF won with like 99% of the votes, right? So it was clearly a stolen election. And that is when they actually started the whole genocide rhetoric. When there was a backlash to that stolen election, they started to say, oh, this is about genocide. No, it's about you as a political group. It's like, you know, it's low. It's like the lies are so low. It's so unbelievable back then. And I was actually shocked to find that they'd already started that rhetoric that far back. So had they been willing to share a little bit of power, had they not been so dominating and brutal, so many tens of thousands of people not able to go back to Ethiopia. I mean, there's folks here that haven't gone back home, you know, before Abiy Ahmed came into power in 20, 25 years. That's a really painful thing. It's one thing when you don't go because it's not convenient for you. It's another when you are not able to go because you don't feel safe in that country. And then so many people also were killed as protesters, as political, people that were considered political competition, a lot of tortures. You know, we know about prisons in the Welkite region in Western Ethiopia, where there's so many skulls that were dug up pre-1991 while they were fighting that government, but also after, when they systematically tried to cleanse the ethnic Amhara people out of that region and annex it to the Tigray region. So there's a lot of resentment and they know it. So when you know you haven't done right by people for that long, then yeah, you're afraid of what they're going to do to you when they had the power. But the Ethiopian people and the Eritrean people have been extremely graceful with letting the TPLF out of power. This current prime minister, couldn't have gotten a better deal. There were a very few people, relatively speaking, that were arrested in the TPLF organization. They were actually asked to join the Prosperity Party, the new coalition party. They were given so many options, 2-3 years of negotiations. I've talked to people that were a part of those negotiations who say they were given every option possible. They were determined to go to war. It wasn't about not getting what they wanted. So when you know that that's what you've been as an entity, then yes, you're going to try to hold on. But if they had a little bit of clarity of mind, if there were some brains in the operation, it feels like the brain died when former Prime Minister Meles Zenawi passed away in 2012. I mean, everything that has happened since is just so belligerent. I mean, you can argue there are so many issues that happened under him, but some things were done well. And so it's because they're a fascist organization and that they don't allow people to even ask questions that they were left with the worst of the worst in terms of intellect. And that low intellect told them that it made sense to start this war with the region in November 2020, not recognizing that even in the best case scenario, if they were to overthrow this government and get into power, they were dealing with almost 110 million people that hated them. So they would have to be even more brutal than they were before to hold on to power. But you can't tell, you know, this kind of empty-headed fascist organization anything.
You know, it also speaks to what you mentioned earlier, which is, of course, like they couldn't have been in power as long as they have. And, you know, they still wouldn't have the power they have if it wasn't for the support of the United States for obviously very imperialist reasons of controlling the Horn of Africa. And, you know, you've visited Ethiopia many times over the last year, I believe. You know, Eugene and I were privileged enough to get to go there last December. And when we were there, Eugene actually did a report on this, like, basically, like, industrial area where there was all these factories that were at threat of basically being shut down and a lot of people losing their jobs because of the U.S. punishing Ethiopia by removing them from the African Growth and Opportunity Act, which was a form of sanctions. And now the U.S. has tried to place more sanctions on Ethiopia. So I'm just curious if you could maybe speak to any of the consequences of those basically policies of economic warfare on the country for refusing to submit to the TPLF, if you've seen like what that's looked like on the ground.
Yes, you know, the people in Ethiopia on the ground have suffered so much because of this war. They've literally been killed when Tigray militias have invaded neighboring regions. The economy is strained because the government is partially focused on this war. And so on top of that, when you see the U.S. taking Ethiopia out of a trade deal that's been there for a very long time, AGOA, and that costing thousands of jobs, mostly women, in the industrial sector, it just doesn't make sense. Why would you punish a people that are already suffering because of this insurgency? So, you know, some people, the TPLFites and some folks in the State Department like to talk about our anti-American sentiment. There is no anti-American sentiment. The majority of the Ethiopian diaspora felt very American, those here in the United States, and they had really positive feelings, regardless of the fact that the U.S. supported the TPLF for as long as they did. They had very positive feelings about the United States government, and they really thought this government would support this transition. They never imagined that they would provide such support to the TPLF in their efforts to try to come back. So in some ways, the way that the United States is acting geopolitically in this conflict really reminds me of the TPLF in that they're not willing to take on new data. You know, this is not the Horn of Africa that they knew in the 90s or in the 2000s. This is a much more conscious population. This is a population that has a government that cares about developing the poorest of people. So they're feeling you know, like they support their government and that they're not actually willing to bend to any sort of outside influence. So the U.S. Behavior and reaction to what's going on in the Horn of Africa is so disgusting, honestly. It just, I don't understand what's going on in this administration. I don't know what their end game is. Even, you know, it just doesn't make sense even by the most greediest imperialist standards to me.
You know, I did mention the No More movement at the outset, and I think it's worth mentioning that, you know, in the diasporic populations really around the world from the Horn of Africa, there's been this huge pushback against, you know, not only the U.S. support for the TPLF, but their war aims. And, you know, I'm curious, I mean, there's so many things we could say about the No More movement, but, you know, one of the things that's been interesting to me about it as well is it feels like it pushes back against a lot of these tropes about the sort of never-ending reality of divisions amongst people in the Horn of Africa. And it's created this really interesting cross-cultural conversation between Ethiopians of all ethnicities, Eritreans, Somalis, you know, other people from the not only the Horn of Africa, Africa itself. I mean, talk about that if you could, because I feel like in a, maybe in a miniature sense perhaps, but certainly in a sense I think makes it worth talking about, it has shown how there's a very different future than what's presented by the TPLF and others, which is sort of like, all these people hate each other, they've all been divided, there's nothing you can do about it, it's thousands of years of history, and you have to have someone like the TPLF that can, you know, keep the lid on that boiling pot because these people are never going to get together.
Yeah, you know, ethnicity is something that the West and the TPLF wants us to talk about. It really, I've never talked more about it. My friends, people around me, just the community in general, have never talked more about ethnicity than we have in the last 2 years, and even as far back in the last 4 years. It's when the TPLF got out of power that we all started talking about ethnicity, because they started talking about ethnicity. They started talking about the federal government and people in the country being against ethnic Tigrayans when they knew very well that it was about the TPLF leadership, right? So there are people that I've known for years that I didn't know what ethnicity they were. I knew they were Ethiopian, but I didn't know what ethnicity they were until 2018, when you would hear things from TPLF supporters that, oh, it's because we're Tigrayan, they're starting to talk about us. And I will say state media in some ways failed when they talked about certain abuses of TPLF actors, because sometimes they would refer to them as Tigrayan speakers. So Tigrayan speakers is not specific enough, right? And those are the kind of things that the TPLFites use and weaponize to say that this is about ethnic Tigrayans. But really, in reality, it wasn't. There's back then, there were ethnic Tigrayan Ethiopians that were living safely all over the country. That is still true now. There's there's ethnic Tigrayan Ethiopians in leadership positions in government in Addis. Those living perfectly fine, living really good lives there and in the diaspora. So we're not that ethnically divided. This is a conversation that has been thrown in our face in the last 4 years and more. More poignantly in the last 2 years because of this conflict. If you look at most family members, they're quote unquote mixed. It's like a joke because we never used to talk like this. You know, you'll have people that are, one parent is from the Amhara region, the other is from the Oromo region, one parent from the Tigray region, one parent from the Amhara region, like all kinds of, you know, what we now refer to as a mix. And it was never an issue before. And as you see, as you both see on, you know, on Twitter spaces, you don't even know what ethnicity people are. We don't ask. It's really not important. You know, the reason that people know where I'm from is because of the way that I came out against the TPLF. Oh, it's an ethnic Tigrayan that's come out against the TPLF. But there's, you know, people that I've known for a long time that said, oh, you're Tigrayan? I had no idea. Yeah, like it was not an important thing. So I think we're proving, you know, what No More was saying is no more to the politics of division that's being fueled through disinformation. You know, the story that the mainstream media was telling, that was, it was disinforming the diaspora and making them think that there were divisions that didn't exist. And in fact, it actually created divisions that weren't there before because of the false narratives. And ultimately, that leads to conflict in the diaspora and war on the ground. But I think we're going to get past it, but it's a lot of work. I mean, it's like, you know, you got to take people with you because there are things that happen on the ground that target particular ethnicities that I believe is meant to elicit a certain response from the diaspora and those in the movement, both in Ethiopia and outside. It's meant to divide us. But that's the kind of education that we continue to have, because the outside influence, the imperialists, the TPLFites are trying to weaponize these things because they see our unity as a threat to them. And it is. And it's something that we continue to try to work on and try to grow, because we know that is the antidote to the ethnic federalism system that the TPLF created for exactly this purpose.
And, you know, Hermela, the, you know, no more despite being suppressed online by Twitter in other ways. I mean, really, I think the first hashtag that I know of to have actually been like actively suppressed by Twitter. You've got the no more is still going strong. You've still been the movement has still been holding protests. I think you have something coming up this weekend, if I'm not mistaken. Why don't you tell us what's going on with that, and also like how people who are watching, if they're not already involved, can get involved.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks, Ronnie, for bringing that up. There is a rally on Sunday, this Sunday, September 18th, in front of the White House at 2 p.m. We are coming together, people of the Horn of Africa, allies, anti-war, anti-imperialist allies, to say, you know, no more to the politics of war, no more to disinformation, division, and war. Ethiopians and Eritreans in particular coming together and calling on the U.S. to condemn the TPLF terrorists and to support the people's governments in the Horn of Africa. It is an important rally, and I encourage anyone who finds this story, familiar in some other context to join us. I think showing the people power is really important. And I want to also add about the Twitter censorship. Yes, no more was disabled within days, and it's never really been enabled as far as we know. The other really important thing is we've had two people with high following. I'll say Simon Tesfamariam, Eritrean organizer, and Nebiyu Asfaw, an Ethiopian-American organizer. Both were taken down within a month or two of the No More movement starting. It was absolutely a political hit. We have no doubt about it. And one of the things that the current ambassador, Mike Hammer, can do, or anyone that's looking to try to bridge some of the gaps that they've created, is bring back those two accounts, Simon Tesfamariam's account and Nebiyu Asfaw's account. There's no reason why they were permanently suspended from Twitter, except that it was a political tool, a geopolitical tool, so that they could isolate people like me, so that I would have to sort of be on my own in this ether. There's so many other people that are with us, that support us on Twitter, but those two in particular have been working on this far longer than I have, and have paved the way for us to be able to say no more. So I think if this administration wants to take a good faith measure in terms of the digital space, that is one thing that they could do, because we know that Twitter works very closely with the State Department. There are no coincidences like the ones that we saw when No More was disabled and their two accounts were taken down, along with two other No More accounts that were central. So the censorship is a huge element of it, and we're rallying in the rally this Sunday. We'll also try to touch on that, but I think that is really worth talking about, because we've sort of let it go because we've had so much to do. But those two accounts are important, and that is that kind of censorship is something that should scare all of us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, Hermela, as always, very, very honored to have you here on the show. Of course, Hermela Aragawi, Ethiopian American journalist, organizer with the No More Movement. And I have to say, I would be remiss if I didn't say, also with roots in Mississippi, U.S. South, we're going to claim you. Wanted to note that as well.
Ronnie teed me up and I dropped the ball, but at Hermela TV on Twitter, at Hermela TV on YouTube. A lot of it goes through Twitter, so you can follow me on there for more. Thank you.
Yes, and tagged in our feed on Twitter, so if somehow you forgot it, go to our feed and you'll get it. But as always, Hermela, really appreciate you giving us some of your time.
Long show. Thank you guys so much.
We're losing it, Ryan.
Well,
slowly
Eugene.
But surely.
Yeah, we did it. We did do it.
Great show. Great guest. We really went all around the world. India, Ireland, Kenya, talked about the Horn of Africa, and Jackson, Mississippi. A lot of bad things going on in the world, but a lot of good people standing up and making their voices heard and pushing back. And I think we can, take some hope in that. I think, for sure, Rania.
I think before we go, we should mention a shout out to those who did donate. Yes. They were all anonymous, anonymous donations. Well, it was just the way we had so many stories to cover, but we, of course, always try to get back around to thanking those who support the show. And it's a good time to say once again, you can support all our programming here by donating on the donation button below, which is on YouTube, or by becoming a patron at patreon.com/breakthroughnews. It's how we're able to grow and bring you this program as well as so many others and a lot of really cool and important coverage of very important worldwide events that we have coming up.
Yes, absolutely. A lot of great coverage. I see what you're doing there, Rania, setting me up to say it. No, we got a lot of fantastic things coming to you on a range of different things, including many, many great dispatches. But I will say we are going to be out for a couple weeks here on the Freedom Side. Why? Because myself and the great Matt Belin, who is behind the scenes, will be going to Brazil to cover the elections. Woo! We're going to be there next week. You can follow us at BT Newsroom across all your social media accounts. We're going to be talking a little bit more about that in the coming days, but we are going to be there on the ground covering what is bound to be a very momentous event for the country of Brazil, for the continent of Latin America, and I think really for the whole world, depending on, well, honestly, either way it happens, I think a lot is going to turn on this. So Breakthrough News will be there to bring it to you and let you see anything. So we'll be back in a couple weeks here on the Freedom Side. But like I said, Rania will have many great dispatches to hold you over until we are reunited. But I think, Rania, that'll more or less do it for us here today. And we will see you in 2 weeks on the Freedom Side.